using him. It's just not right. So I said, I'm going to announce that I'm back on the bus. Now, I must say, I expect to be there, but it depends on his conduct. I mean, the one thing I think I have taught politicians out of that race is, which is my message, don't take the Jews for granted. I mean, the Jews invariably vote for the Democratic ticket. 78% voted for Obama. The only higher group were the blacks, about 95%. But as of this moment, I think that the Jews are down to 50 or even lower.
Let me bridge back to local question. You and I both have had encounters with Jesse Jackson.
Yeah.
Mine probably less contentious than yours.
Yeah.
And if I recall, in 88, you said Jews would be crazy to vote for Jesse Jackson.
I did.
And some have said that that stance might have cost you the primary against,
I don't think so.
Against
but
others.
They always leave out, not that you intentionally left it out, because the press was only reported it once in the Times. My exact quote was, Jews would be crazy to vote for Jesse Jackson in the same way that blacks would be crazy to vote for George Bush. They left that out because it doesn't suit their purposes. What's so interesting to me is I have always taken the position that if I'm attacked unfairly, I will respond. Correspondence. And I have kept that position and I'm very proud of it. It happened recently with the Times. Times did an article about 2 weekends ago maybe, in which they said three terms bad, look at Bloomberg, and they go through his record and so forth. I happen to think he's a magnificent mayor. But that's what they said, and then they said, and there was Koch in his third term, while his integrity is unimpeachable, he had this scandal, that's the Manus and Friedman, and his third term was rubble. I thought to myself, rubble? So I write a letter to the Times. I didn't think they'd print it, but they did the very next day. I want to give them credit for it. And I said, can you really call rubble the fact that I created the law that gave homosexuals in New York City civil rights in the private sector? That I built 250,000 housing units that your reporter says rebuilt the city? That I created public financing system, which is the envy of the United States. This is all my third term. And that I created the first legislation to bar smoking in restaurants. I said, that's rubble? Well, they printed it, and that's all that I want.
What would the fourth term have looked like?
It would have had an obituary, mine.
So you're
no, it's too much. I believe three terms is fine. I would not reduce it to less than that, although we have reduced it to two. I think three is fine. But more than that, you just don't have the strength.
So in retrospect, you're just as happy that three terms was...
I wrote a book, actually the last book I wrote, but I'm going to write another. No, I wrote nonfiction book called Remaining Relevant. And since that time, I've written a children's book with my sister. it's to teach children to stay, not to get fat, because I was a fat kid. I mean, I remember how terrible it was when I got into the playground and they called me Fatso. So I'm running around now with my sister, who co-wrote the book with me, she has seven grandchildren, and we go to bookstores and A lot of kids come. It's very, very nice. But I'm very happy. The question most asked of me, and I suppose of any retiring public official, is, do you miss it? Like it's something really wonderful, Godiva chocolates. And the answer is, I don't miss it at all. At all. For me, it's the new challenges. I put out this commentary every week. I love writing. I love writing. And the movie reviews, and I have a radio show and a television show. I'm really busy.
And still relevant. Let me ask one more question, then we'll open it up to the audience. And this comes from your commentary. You said that banking executives ought to face criminal charges for their role in the financial crisis, pretty strong language. What do you make of the wave of anti-Wall Street protests, not just here, but across the country? And how do you think the demonstrations and the anger behind those demonstrations will play into the 2012 elections?
Okay. It won't be this group that will be having an impact on the elections, in my judgment. The elections will be decided on an economic issue. It'll be jobs. And that's not what this group is all about. Half of them don't know why they're protesting. They're looking for a cause. And the other half sense that there is an outrageous situation in this country where the rich get richer and the poor have children, which is a very old statement. And it's true. But what has bothered me, and what I have talked about in my commentaries for several years now, is that the people who caused the Great Recession in part, they don't get punished. To create civil fines for them. Take Goldman Sachs. I have nothing against Goldman Sachs. Or take Citibank. Goldman Sachs was fined by the SEC $550 million. To them, it's the cost of business. But anybody who's fined $550 million, do you think you could find some criminal violations there? I think so. If you don't, go see the movie Margin, or whatever. It is a wonderful movie. I saw it yesterday. Wonderful movie. Citibank. $285 million is what they were fined. You think that they did anything? I do. I don't have any proof, but that's for the SEC and the Attorney General, not just them, but so many others. It didn't happen by itself. And we also know that when somebody steals a bike, in fact, in this town, it was shameful, and I happen to have a very high regard for Ray Kelly, a wonderful man. But this particular act, whether it was his or else others, I don't know, of setting up a sting, going to delivery boys or men, most of them are men, and said, would you like to buy a hot bike? We got a nice stolen bike here, very cheap. Guy buys it, he's arrested. And in the first case, which was reported in the Times, he's an illegal Mexican, and they ship him home. Now, I happen to believe in shipping on their own. I wouldn't put them on boxcars or buses, but there are many ways you can get them to go home. Just let me mention that. I doubt that there's a single person in this room that knows the Mexican unemployment rate. If you do, raise your hand, but don't speak, say it. You don't. I do. It's 5.1%. The unemployment rate in the United States is 9.1%. We should be going down there. If you were to put people in jail, employers who gave jobs, these people would go home. In fact, a million of them went home with the crackdown. And then you have in the city, I can't believe this, in the city and state of New York, They're refusing to cooperate with a program where the, this is Obama. You can be sure if it's an Obama program, it's not an outrageous program. It's not against minorities. It's ridiculous. He has a program that says when somebody is arrested and you have his fingerprints here in New York City, in New York State, send them to the FBI and to Homeland Security, and we'll check it and see whether they're illegals, and we'll ship them home. And New York City says, no, we're not going to cooperate. No, it's they don't like the program. Now, there were some figures, I don't have them all in my head, but I think they said they shipped home last year about 360,000 people. 51,000 were three crimes, murderers, sex crimes, and one other major crime. Shouldn't they get shipped home? Wouldn't you like that? And then they said, people who run the program, this is the Obama people who run the program, and he said the balance of the people were people overwhelmingly who had been shipped home and came back or were newly arrived. They were first time newly arrived. I mean, no country has open borders.
But you said you're for higher quotas, though, aren't you?
Say it again?
Aren't you for higher quotas?
I am for legal immigration. You can triple it. I am for immigration. I hear the some of the talking heads saying it's absolutely outrageous that anybody would be against immigration. That's fundamental, and on and on and on. And but they always leave out illegal. Up until recently, the Times left out illegal. Always undocumented aliens, like you left your papers at home. I mean, that's what they wanted to convey. No, but Moynihan said it best of all. What is it now? Defining deviancy down. If you conclude, well, I can't handle this program, so I'll make it legal. Well, we can't handle illegal aliens, so we won't make them illegal anymore. Come on!
I'm Byron Ween. I wonder if you could comment on the current state of New York City finances and whether the taxation program that we have in effect in the city is going to be sufficient for the next mayor to balance the budget.
I really shouldn't voice an opinion because I don't really know what the current situation is, other than what Mayor Bloomberg has announced. I think they have announced that there is a $3 billion deficit for next year. But let me say this. I came in 1978. Every year since 1978, the city has had to issue a four-year plan, outgoing plan. People who were familiar with what was being done understood that the only thing that really had any credibility were the first 2 years, the year that you're in and next year. The third and fourth year of that plan, it was out of sight, the money that we would need to balance the budget. And it never happened other than we balanced the budget. Now, I don't say take it for granted, but there is such enormous strength in this city, unbelievable, enormous strength. And I believe that we are ahead of most cities, if not all cities in this country, in our stability and future.
Next question, Bill Hubbard. Going to come to this side of the room next, so be quick.
I have two questions, but I'll save one for later. Question involves employment. And since we're in Roosevelt House, Robert Shiller, the economist, wrote a piece in the Times about 6 months ago saying, what would Roosevelt do? And in it, he proposed reestablishing the WPA, i.e. a full employment program. Now, this has never been mentioned in the last 2 years, as far as I can tell, on a national level. Is there any possibility of that happening? And why isn't it discussed?
Let me say this. I have in my commentary said, why don't we bring back the Roosevelt programs, the one you talk about, WPA, PWA, and the CCC. Those are the three major programs for work. But the truth of the matter is, that's not what's going to change the country. The jobs that count are private sector jobs. Government jobs do not count in my book or most people's books. President's job program currently and earlier, basically to save government jobs in large number. I don't think that's what our goal should be. Our goal should be the private sector jobs. So, and I have said this, and I get a, in my commentary, and I just got a commentary back saying, are you sure you're a Democrat? Well, I write back saying, what is it you disagree with me on? I'm not an ideologue. Tell me what you don't like. Now, there's no question but that whether it's a Republican or a Democrat who says, you should look at the restrictions that we have on business or on oil. I mean, take the people who oppose getting natural gas from our huge new resources upstate. I believe the commission's report, Andrew Commission's report, it said you don't fool around with areas with the water supplies, but there are a whole host of areas where you can safely dig. Now, nothing is perfect. Whenever you put oil in a ship, you run the risk that it's going to have a spill. We have seen those spills far greater than any other damage we've seen other than nuclear damage. And I'm for closing the nuclear facility Indian Point. But I'm for digging for oil. I'm for digging for oil in the Arctic. I just saw an op-ed article that said, or maybe it was even a news article, that said Russia has gotten one of the American oil companies to dig for oil in the Arctic that we won't permit to dig in the Arctic on the American side. Now, does anybody believe that if that, firstly, I'm going to assume that the Russians are desirous of clean environment and everything else, and I'm also going to assume that the companies recognize a responsibility. But does anybody believe that if they make a mistake on the Russian side, it's not going to affect the same ocean on our side? It's ridiculous. For us to be spending something like $500 billion every year to the oil-producing companies, that's nuts. And then I wrote a letter to any agency in government, whether it's Democrat or Republican, is a waste of time, but I do it anyway. just for the record, so to speak. And I wrote this letter some time ago in which I said, I am told that if you required every 18-wheel trailer, those are the big trailers, to use natural gas, that it would reduce our purchases from OPEC by 50%, and that if you would require that every existing truck be changed so that it could use natural gas, it would cost $60,000 for the conversion. Why don't we lend the money interest-free? Why don't we require the truck manufacturers to build these trucks? No answer. But doesn't it make sense?
Another question here. Yes, ma'am. We'll get you a mic. And you'll tell us who you are.
Annalise Marks. I'd like to ask you, Mr. Mayor, why do you not believe, I understand what you're saying about private sector jobs, but why not CCC, WPA, and PWA?
I'm not against it, but it's not the answer to our country. That's, I'm not against it. The fact is, I've written saying, why don't we do it, just like you're saying. But it is not the answer. Private sector jobs are far more important to this country than government job. I mean, the government, I've been in government. In the private sector, you don't work, you get fired. In the public sector, you don't work, and we try to fire you, you get a grievance. And you have to go through for like 2 years before you can get rid of somebody. It's not what I'm for.
Yeah. Another question. Mark.
Mark Willis, I won't ask about housing. You've already made the great case for what was a terrific housing program that continues really to this day. Okay, is that better? All right, so I'm Mark Willis, and I did work in the Koch administration of housing, and I won't ask a question about that. What I am interested in is the relationship with Albany. A little bit of history or your perspective on that, and what you think about that relationship today in terms of how much Albany regulates what happens in the city.
Well, it's the same.
Let me just say, including pensions, pension reform.
That's the primary. We do not have home rule in New York State. For the most part, any important item to increase taxes, to lower taxes, either way, you must secure the permission of the Albany legislature, a law to be signed by the governor. It's an outrage that the city of New York should have imposed on it, as the state legislature and the governor, depending on who the governor was, issues, requirements that they don't impose on themselves. They would increase, and good people like Stanley Fink, who was probably the best speaker the state's ever had, who was a personal friend, Hugh Carey, who was a personal friend, the greatest governor the state's ever had, they would bend to the union importuning. I remember going up to Albany to fight a pension proposed increase. And there were two firefighters who were lobbying, going into all the legislators' offices. And they saw me. They liked me. They came over and they said, Mayor, you're wasting your time. We have a handshake with Warren Anderson. He was the Republican majority leader. You're wasting your time. I wanted to kill them. But they were trying to be helpful to me. Why am I spending my energy on something I can't change? And they got their pension. It was the cost was $100 million a year. It's a lot of money. And I said, I'm going to tell every constituent in every district what you cost them, how many parkies I had to lay off, how many teachers, and whatever else it was. And so they didn't like this because there's an election coming up and I had some impact. I was liked primarily by the people in the city. And so one day, Barry Feinstein, a union leader, Teamster, called, could he come and see me? And I said, sure. So he came to Gracie Mansion. He said, Mayor, we want to shut this, quote, we want to shut you up. And so I have an offer. We will allow the pension bill to take effect 4 months later than is currently in the proposed law. And that will save you $70 million one-time savings. So I had this internal conversation. What am I supposed to do? Am I supposed to feel good and say, get out of here? No. And lose $70 million for a city that was strapped for money, and I'll feel good because I wouldn't be extorted, but nevertheless, we're going to pay the money. I couldn't. And so I said, I'll take the deal. I had no recourse. Now, it can only be changed in one way, and it's never going to be changed, because the legislators are not going to allow it. They love this power that they have. They love it. So that's the answer.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
purple.
Hello, Mayor. Helene from the old neighborhood. You hear me? Helene from the old neighborhood, long time ago. I wanted to know.
I was born in the Bronx. Is that the neighborhood?
Brooklyn.
Speak right into it, ma'am.
Brooklyn that you never talk about.
Go ahead.
Hold the mic a little closer.
Okay, that's better. I've been aware of the loans that the students are so burdened with in the city schools.
Yeah.
And being a student myself now at Hunter, I see most of these students hold two and three jobs just to keep themselves afloat. Do you have any ideas of how that can be handled in a way where maybe...
Well, I've been thinking about it. And the easiest thing to say and make myself popular, certainly with you, is to say, forgive it. How can you forgive $1 trillion? The loans are now in excess owed are $1 trillion. Would you have the federal government at this point in its life cycle with
no.
all... You wouldn't,
no.
right? Neither
about,
would I.
What about the future and how that can be
Well,
handled?
The future will have to, it depends on the state of our finances. Now, the question is, how did it get that way? How did it get, how did, should everybody go to college? You think so? I don't think so. I think you have to be sufficiently qualified. I don't know what qualified means, C, C plus, B, testing. But should everybody go to college? Well, how many of you think graduate? I'm now grasping from my memory. I think 21% of the people who go to the two-year college, 21% is my recollection, actually graduate. I mean, I don't know. I'm not going to tell you I know why. But, I mean, shouldn't that be looked at in an intelligent way? Is it being unfair to say that